Hello, welcome to Tight Lines. As far as the weatherman says, we're now into autumn, and along with mists and mellow fruitfulness, we've probably the best fishing of the year coming up. Nowhere more is that true than in carp angling, and Jerry Hammond, who joins us in the body this evening, is just the man to help us exploit the excellence that's on its way. He's one of the country's top carpers, as well as a fishery manager, so he's definitely a man in the know. Also coming up, we're getting out on the bank with Jerry at his own Hertfordshire venue, where he tried to tempt out one of the bigger residents for us, as well as enjoying a bit of river action. You can see how things panned out at last weekend's Maver Match This final at Larford Lakes, where 24 top match anglers went head-to-head for a £72,000 prize fund. I'll have my regular look at the sport currently being found by all types of anglers around the UK. There'll be useful tips on the species to target and the best tactics to use. I'll also be announcing August winners in our Young Angler of the Month photo competition. It may be back to school, but they'll certainly have a spring in their step. It's good to see you, Jerry. How's things been,
mate? Good to see you, Keith. Yeah, really well, thank you. Thanks very much.
It's a long time since you've been here. It seems like, to me, a long time.
A couple of years, I think.
Is it?
As long as that? Yeah, I'm
sure. But I asked you if you had a fish that you were really proud of in the ensuing period.
Yep.
And this is it.
I've got a couple this year, but that is probably, like, it's beautiful. You can see it's a stunning carp.
It's a gorgeous looking fish. Yep. Really is. Where's that from?
That's from Frimley, Pit 3.
Oh, because that Frimley's very famous for its commons, isn't it? But it's got the odd fully scaled.
It's got some massive commons in there to just, £50.
Oh.
The big one, they're called Charlie's Mates, £50. And there's various other ones that back that up as well. And then not only that, there's three or four like that, big plated mirrors, that's the biggest plated mirror I've ever caught, and it's like...
They're glorious. There's something special about them, isn't they look old school and they look fit and they're just good-looking fish.
They're just like just awesome carp when their scale patterns like that. I've always wanted to catch a big fully and I got one this year, so I'm more than happy.
Got anything like that in Carthage?
Yeah, we've got a few. Not quite as big as that. Sort of mid 30s.
Oh.
But they're few and far between some of them real big ones like that.
Yeah. Beautiful, beautiful fish, mate. Well done. I'll be proud of that.
Cheers.
Well, Jerry's lucky enough to have a stretch in the River Lee running through the Carthagena fishery in Hertfordshire, so when the going gets tough on the carp lakes, he's always got an alternative. Having said that, when we paid him a visit on a beautiful morning last week, he was feeling pretty positive.
So here I am on the main lake. I've done the night last night, and around about 4:30 in the morning, I've had a take. I've come flying out the bivvy, picked the rod up. First thing I see is a shooting star. I think I'm going to have a lucky night tonight. But sadly, it's horrendously weedy out there, and sadly, the fish weeded me up, and I ended up losing it. But, you know, it's still time. We've got a few hours to go yet before sort of, I would say, bite time finishes. So I'm really hopeful of trying to pick one up for the camera. Set up for this session is a 15-pound GR60, a real nice strong line. That's spliced onto 4 foot of lead core and then a good old trusty chod rig. And the reason I'm using the chod rig is because the lake bed out there is heavily dense weed and there are some nice little clear spots, and as long as I can find one of them, I'm sure that this will always be presented. The reason it's so good and so effective is the hook section itself actually moves, it's free, and it'll move up to the stop. The stop is at a chosen depth that I kind of feel I need to use on top of the weed for it to settle back down. The hook section is a stiff filament whipped to a size 5 chod hook, and I'm using just a 14mm nut flavoured boilie pop up. Thank you. Right, I've given it the best shot. Time's cracking on a bit now, nothing's happening. It's gone really quiet, so I'm going to reel the rods in. And being the angler that I am, I still want to get a bite of some sort. I've got the river just behind me, so I'm going to reel them in and pop over there and see how my luck goes. I've moved down onto the weir pool. It's a fantastic little chub spot here, but unfortunately, just recently, the big willows come down, and that's where they all used to hold up. I'm going to give it a go, nevertheless, and see if the chub are still around. We'll see what happens. I'm pleased to the fact that there's still some chub here. This is the awkward bit, I've just got to try and coax it back through the cabbages. Normally they just kick their way out, but there's quite dense down there with them. Come on. That's it, we're over the cabbages now. But there you go, one of the weir pool chub. To be fair, it's quite a small one for the standard of this place, but it's nice to know there's still a few about. I'm going to get the rod back out and see if I can catch his big brother. Right, the rig I'm using couldn't get any simpler. It's just a sliding Arsley bomb, down to a bead and a little ring swivel. Then I've got about 8 inches, depending on how deep I want to fish it, of 6-pound hook link, down to a small hook, and then the secret is the little pop-up, trimmed up pop-up, and this will now sit off the bottom 6 or 8 inches and waft about naturally, and I believe the chub like to take a moving bait. Let's have a go. Contend with the cabbages again. Come on. It's another chub falling for the floating bait. Come on. There you go, another little weir pool chub. And I say little, and I don't mean to be funny by that. I mean, this is a small chub by the standards of this weir pool. This is a baby. So nevertheless, it's another bite. I'm gonna cast back out and see if any of his older brothers or sisters are still in there, still in the pool. Let's get him back. Come on. Back through the same route again, through the cabbages. And that's the third one there, falling to the trimmed up pop-up. This proves to me that they do like to take a bait just off the bottom. Lovely. They're getting bigger. That one there's about 5 pound. Lovely chub, but I still know they go bigger. Probably about 3 pound bigger than this. But I'll tell you what, you wouldn't mind that on the end of a waggler rod. Right, I've had a few nice chub this afternoon. But I'm going to finish off there and head back to the main lake and try my luck at a carp. So I'm hoping I'll have something to report when I'm in the studio.
That was smashing it, mate. You know, I was on holiday a couple of years ago and I saw a sign in a shop window that you sort of sign you hang on your wall. It said, if you're lucky enough to live by the river, you're lucky enough. And I think we can safely say you're lucky enough, can't we, mate?
I'm very lucky, mate. God, very lucky.
Blessed. Although you went back to the lake, you didn't actually catch that afternoon.
No.
But since then,
yep.
You've had this from the same swim, was it?
Yep. Yeah, I went and got the rods back out that evening. As we said earlier on in the film, it's really weedy. It's probably the weediest I've ever seen the lake, to be honest, and hence using chod rigs to try and get the spots. And I was lucky enough to get a bite. Didn't get too much trouble off it, actually. Weeded me, but I managed to land it.
Yeah.
And one of the old ones, they're all very old in there. It's a fish known as single scout. £32. I was actually made up. This is one I've never caught.
It's your first time you caught that one?
That fish, yeah.
Really?
And I've lived there 12 years and I've caught a lot of them, but I don't like to fish it too often in case I catch them all.
Yeah, and then, like me, see, although you're used to catching these fish, once the mystery goes, it's close the door and go somewhere else, didn't you? And that must be terrible when you live there.
Yeah, and every now and then I seem to just drop on there and get one of the ones on there, so I'm quite lucky.
Fantastic, mate. Well done. Welcome back. Carp angler and fishery manager Jerry Hammond is my guest this week. And I suppose the main theme that we've seen so far, especially in your film, is the subject of weed.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of it about this time of year. It's dying back a bit, but there's still some fairly luxuriant growth, isn't there?
Yeah, I mean, it dies back, but it's still there. It's sunk down on the bottom. Mm. It still creates a lot of problems in presenting a bait.
Mm.
So that's where this type of presentation comes into play.
The chod rig, and I thought, was it Terry Earn that first called it chod? I think it probably was.
The chod father.
But it's Terry. Yes, exactly right. But it's a great description of it, isn't it? If you ever wanted to pick a word that sounded like what it says, then chod is the one. It's the miscellaneous bits of rubbish. I used to call it black bottom.
Yeah.
The stuff that you get on the bottom of lakes and rivers this time of year, dead and decaying weeds and leaves. And
sometimes
stuff.
It's there at some quite, you know, fairly high levels on the bottom as well, and presenting baits is really hard sometimes, you know.
Fish love rooted in it, though, don't they? Because things like bloodworm, hoglouse, different nymphs and invertebrates live in and amongst it, and things hide in it, so it's a great place.
They're always in and out of it all day long. You see the bubblers going, you know, they're rooting around in the weed.
Yeah.
And definitely throughout the daytime, it's a good place to have a bait.
Yeah. You know? And as you said, the chod father, the chod rig, and this is the classic chod rig. I'm just going to pull that through to there. Jerry, now if you can just describe it for us in its simplicity.
Yep.
This, of course, is lead core.
Yep, which
lead
sinks.
Core lead, it sinks to the bottom, nails itself down. And this, and then the next important thing, I suppose, is the bait.
Yeah.
Because that doesn't sink, does it?
No, the bait's buoyant, and you have a length of lead core, depending on how long you like to fish it. I use about 4 foot. Unless I'm fishing into real smaller holes in the weed. But basically, the top bead moves up the lead core.
That's the top bead there.
Yeah.
You can set that
To what depth you think you want to fish in the weed, basically. And also that little bead's a safety bead, which will, when it's wet, will just push off over the top.
Can I pull that off?
Yeah, sure.
That just slides off there.
Yeah. And then with the swivel, having a big ring swivel on it, that will just, if you cut off or...
That's the big ring swivel there, you see?
That, as a safety point of view, would just pull off over the top of the tube in there and you're not trailing, the fish is not trailing a length of lead core around with it. So that's the safety side of it.
It's an incredibly safe rig.
Yep.
And you've only got a very, very short, very stiff hook length.
Yeah.
This bit here, which is...
Is curved.
Curved. Yep. Why is it curved into that shape?
Just got better hooking properties, I believe.
It creates like a circle hook effect.
Yeah,
almost like not quite as severe, but a withy pull type.
Definitely,
Withy pull was a very famous rig, of course, with a big curved hook.
That's one.
A lot of fisheries don't allow those because the hook penetrates more and more as the pressure goes on. But with the curved mono, of course, when
obviously
a fish pulls
it's got movement.
Well, it straightens as the fish fights. That goes straight and it curves back again. This nice little D-rig setup you've got here, I don't think you can see it because of my pork sausages in the way. But that little deal, I notice you've got the bait itself on a ring. I know some people use little swivels and what's that?
Well, for years we tied baits on and a lot of people still do, but they come out of a new type of attachment. It's like a ball ring that bores into the bait and that is actually fitted onto the D of the rig. and basically it just keeps it intact. You can cast them out long range, they don't come off. And the good thing about it is, which was like really interested me, on them freezing cold mornings and you're trying to put tie a new bait on, the lighter keeps going out as you have to dab, and your hands are froze with them, just screw them on, cast them out. Fantastic bit of kit.
And also, let's face it, you can't see anything tied on. I mean,
no.
I don't like pellet bands that much. I'll try to use a lasso.
Yeah.
But even that gives you a bit of mono, but that just hides it completely. And, of course, it's absolutely safe because that bait's never going to go into a fish's mouth and stay there.
No.
So it's never going to ingest that, never going to swallow
it. Even if it took the bait as well, the actual ring stays on the D.
Yeah.
So it doesn't come off with it.
And if I can just, if we can just between us explain how this works. So you cast it in, posh, that hits the bottom.
Yep.
This will then
float up towards
slide up there.
Yeah.
Of course, over the weed.
Yeah, and then the whole lot just gently settles down and takes the contour, hopefully, of the weed bed.
Yeah.
And therefore, you can, obviously, I mean, if you want to fish it on fairly clear toddy bottom, I mean, not so severe, you can fish shorter hook lengths like if you want. But then as it gets weedier, I pull the stop up further.
Yeah.
And then fish it with a longer hook section.
Yeah. Now, this is interesting because this is sort of the next phase, if you like. Let's move old style chod out the way.
Yeah.
And this is quite new, and this is the naked chod.
Well, it's been around a while now, but it's like they ever call it the chod on the line or a naked chod.
And the reason why this is fished on a mono leader.
Yep.
Right.
Yep.
Do you use a heavier leader than your main line?
I used to use like a fluorocarbon leader of 20 odd foot, but I don't seem to need the point now with the good lines that are out now. I mean, this particular line takes on, it sinks, so it's doing the same as what the previous leaders that we used to use.
And it eliminates a knot.
Yeah.
And every knot is a weed. No matter how good the knot is weaker than the weakest line it's tied onto.
And
so
it attracts big balls of weed as well.
Yeah, exactly.
You know?
Now, and that works, it works exactly the same way, it's just on mono.
And because it's not on lead core, you have to weight the actual
The
ring swivel.
Ah, you've got a bit of tungsten putty.
Yeah, I've got
it
on the other one as well.
Yeah.
This is needed more on this one. You drop it in the margins and you watch it slowly sink down. And to be honest, like that rig in the margins it's invisible apart from the hook. Apart from the hook bait.
And that's what you want it to be, isn't it?
Mm. Yeah.
Now, one thing that I know so many anglers, there's two things in fishing that people are dead scared of.
Yeah.
One is they're using bread and the bread comes off. Two is when they're fishing, they've got weed on the hook.
Yeah.
And every time you wound in on that lake, I know it was weed on the hook.
Yeah.
But you wound that on. That wasn't on there while you were fishing,
basically,
was it?
Basically, if you looked, most of the weed was around the lead.
Yeah.
And then when you do start to reel in, if you come across like a little shallow, like a weed bed on your way in, this hook will obviously grab against the weed and pull down against the lid. So you're going to bring in a little bit of weed. But up until it hit that weed bed, that would have been free of weed.
Yeah, and I like to just emphasise that because people are they're paranoid about having weed, bread coming off, weed on hook.
Yeah.
That's the two things I find people are paranoid. Now, the third thing while we're talking about weedy lakes, let's talk about playing fish in weed. Because I've got this theory that once a fish gets a bit of weed over its head, it gives up, goes to sleep.
Exactly.
And if you can move the weed, you'll move the fish and the whole lot's in front of you.
I've caught so many fish in really dense weed and like they weed you up. It's inevitable. It's going to happen if you're fishing a weedy swim. And nine times out of ten, once they're weeded out, I think, right, it's a bit easier now. And you can just slowly coax them out. I think people rush it too much, but I'll wait for ages until you feel them kick in. And generally, they kick a big ball of the weed apart and they come in with a little bit of weed over their face, masking their view, and they don't tend to fight. And they go in the net, the fish is not harmed, no mouth damage or nothing. Yeah. It's just a good way of landing them, really.
But there's two ways to do it. The way never to do it is jerking. Never, ever, ever do that. Constant pressure, or sometimes opening the bow, putting the rod down for a minute will work,
definitely,
won't it?
Yeah. I tend to keep the leads on as well. A lot of people dump the leads, but I tend to keep them on because I feel that.
Well, with the chud, I think it's different. If you're fishing the lead above the rig, it's different. With the chud, it's different because the lead's behind anyway.
Yeah. So
now, the other thing, let's have a look about baits. Now, these, they're just standard boilers. These are the sort of things that you'd feed.
Yeah. Well, these, I mean, depending what time of year it is, if it was the autumn, I'd be putting a food bait in.
Yeah.
But I've had so much success fishing, like, a scattering of white baits over the top and then my white hook bait.
So would you describe that as a food bait or is that an attraction
bait? It is a very good winter bait, this one. It's called the Wicked Whites, and the reason it's so good, it's a milk protein, easily digestible.
Yeah.
At that time of year, there's no oils and stuff like that in it for the fish to put up with. This particular one's like a creamy, toffee sort of mapley sort of flavour. The good part about it is it's easily digestible, and I think the fish soon sort of realise that.
Yeah.
But getting back to the way I fish it, I would fish any particular bait out there that's a good food source to get the fish interested.
Yeah.
Once they're interested and they're feeding, I think the key then is, to, for me, I'll just scatter a nice little scattering of them over the whole area and put my white one in the way. And to be honest, I think they go from they start picking out them white ones and they go to the next one and the next one. They're already confident.
Yeah.
And then your hook bait follows.
Yeah. Now, I didn't really want to do this. I know we've got a zig. I want to look at the zigs a bit later on.
Yeah.
But, mate, can I just...
I think that's good.
It is a very good, very good, very good chub rig. This is the chub rig. I've got to say, it's slightly more simple.
Yeah. I'm no big chub angler.
No, that's... But when, look, I'll tell you what, mate, the principle is so right, because if I could improve this at all, I'd shorten that hair.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you why. Chub are the worst fish to hair rig for, because what they tend... I'm going to do it with one of your boilies, because there's not a hook on it. What I see chub
they
doing is that.
It, they may have it, yeah. And that's when your rod tip's just knocking like that, isn't it? And you know they're on it.
They pick it up like that, you get a little voip, but you pull it out their mouth. And with a hair rig, there's less chance of them getting in. So what I do, I tie my bait really tight to the back of the hook, so that the bait is actually bending into the hook. And like that, you get a pickup, you get that, you see, you know it's a chub because it's bosh, and then it's woof, and you know it's on.
And they fight.
But people, they do fight, they're brilliant, brilliant fish, yeah. And it's lovely to have that that kind of swim, just coach and try these things out.
Yeah, well, that's it. I mean, like, I mucked around with stuff, and basically, like, we used to feed them a lot of chum mixers and stuff like that, and they were just crazy at taking stuff on the top. I don't know if it's the same when you feed maggots in and they're mid-water taking maggots. They just seem to pick that up more than they would on the bottom, personally.
Yeah, it's terrific. Enjoyed that. Well done. Lovely film. Thank you.
Cheers.
For course anglers, the only possible negative about stillwater fishing is the lack of wind, as bream are bang in the mood and they really like a decent ripple. So if you're targeting the old pin lids, look for a breeze and fish in it, using ground bait or even method feeders and 10mm white or pink boilies on the hair. Crucians are back feeding in. It's far better for them now than it was in high summer. The margins are where to look, very close in if there's enough water, over half a metre, 2 foot or so. And they'll take a decent-sized bait too. Corn, 8mm jelly pellet, or pieces of paste the size of a processed pea would be my choice, over loose-fed 4mm carp pellets. Don't fish too light, though, as carp or tench can muscle in on exactly the same spots, and you don't want to lose a bonus fish. Now, as we spoke to you about Jerry earlier for carp, get on the zig rigs over that dead and dying weed. And what about on the chug rigs, rather? Sorry, I said rigs wrong. Got another couple of months for them yet. Now, the important thing for me this time of the year is baiting.
Yeah.
Do you use more bait this time of the year because the fish are on the munch?
Basically, it's all about watercraft. As the year goes on, the days get shorter, the fish are aware of the fact that it's time to feed. And I just look for where most of the time you find them in the silt pockets, mainly in the deeper water, because that's where the silt's gathering between the bars.
Mm.
And you get the pinprick signs of feeding spots, basically. So I'll keep an eye out for them areas, and I'll start trickling a bit of bait near to them areas and hope that the fish move onto my spots. And as the bites or takes become more so, I'll pre-bait them areas, like, you know.
Oh, yeah.
And then move on to them. You know, that's where I play.
Yeah, but when you talk about baiting, are you a boilie man? All boilies, or do you use like a bit of particle?
Yeah, I don't mind a bit of particle, but in the autumn, as they need this food to get them through their winter months, I think you can't beat a good like food source as a high protein boilie at that time of year, like towards the autumn, coming on early winter. It's something that's going to see them through them colder months.
Please don't say early winter yet, please.
It ain't far away.
No, you're right, it's not far away.
It's not far.
Now, you talk about fishing the silt pockets.
Yeah.
There's two kinds of silt. There's good silt and bad silt, isn't there? How do you find that, you know, that black, stinky, horrible, smelly stuff?
I've actually put bait in them spots.
Have you?
So, yeah, on my brook lake, we fed it with pellet and stuff like that, and the fish were fizzing in it, like, you know, so they were obviously...
Even in the nasty stuff?
Yeah, they didn't seem that bothered about foraging around in it. The food was there, they knew the food was there, and they just sort of they got in there and got stuck in.
Now, when you're feeding, you're putting bait on those soft silt spots, and it gets buried, it sinks in. I mean, I've tried it myself, and boilies go in and just leave a little bit showing, and the fish do dig them out.
Definitely.
Now, your fish will pop up over those, or do you want your hook bait to do the same thing?
I'll try whatever, I will fish pop ups over it, but I do also still fish bottom bait, snowmans slowly sink in. I mean, if the fish are really getting in the bloodworm up to their gills, then a bait that sinks into the silt's not a problem.
No, that's
really not a problem.
And the fish are... Bloodworm is a fantastic natural food source. Yeah. Virtually every fish. And carp, as we know, love it. And you know, I've been carp fishing and bream fishing, I've come in quite often with bloodworm on my bomb or on my feeder if I'm bream fishing. Do you ever try and mimic that? Do you try and use a bloodworm flavouring, or do you think, right, they're eating the naturals, I can't compete with that, I'm going to put my own stuff in that's maybe even better for them?
Yeah, I think they're heavily feeding on the natural food anyway, so all I want to do is get a food bait as close to where they're feeding or where they're feeding to just try and induce a bite. And I think if there's bait lights on a spot near there as well, they're more likely to be hanging in that area, and it's an easy option for them to get their heads down and have a feed up.
Mm. So there probably won't be much weed on the gravel bars on the top of it. So did you sort of avoid the gravel this time?
I'm only fishing like the areas where the fish are, so I'm looking for the silty spots behind the gravel bars. Mm. So if they're bubbling in the silt, I'll be fishing in the silt. There's no point.
No.
I'm not saying you won't catch them on the bars, but if they're in the silt, I'm fishing in the silt. And that's what I'm looking for.
The three most important things are carp fishing: location, location, and location.
Location is so important.
Observation as well.
Yeah, definitely, 100%. Yeah. I mean, and if you know a lake and you know the habits of the fish, then half your work's already done. You know, you just got to get in them areas and try and find them.
Yeah. Now, I did make the mistake of saying a zig rig, but you bought a zig rig in, and I know it's more of a tactic for later in the year, but as the nights do start to go, I hate to say it, to go in, it gets cooler, the algae levels drop out, the water gets clearer. Zigs are deadly in clear water, aren't they?
Yep.
I'm just going to use my stunt thumb for that, just to show. Now, that is a zig rig as you'd use it.
Yeah, there's a lot of different ways of using this. There's lots of different types of zig hook bait, should I say, now, from like a zig bugs to bits of foam, cork, a little bit of boilie, anything. But I quite like just to use a little tiny bit of black foam like that, shaped to how you see it. And I've actually caught them on tiny, as long as I can get that hook up and it can hold the hook link up, I've caught the most smallest bits of foam.
It's amazing, really. I mean, you bought a couple of variations. You said about bugs there. Now, that's like a blue bottle. I don't know if you can see that. It's just, you can just see the little sort of wings on it there. And there's another, that's like a spidery beetly thing, which is more or less the same.
These are generally good, like in really good daylight conditions.
Yeah.
And you know, you're just trying to get that one bite. But I've caught in the middle of the night on black foam.
Yeah. I'm just going to just give you an example of what you can do with your watercraft, using your tactics, right? I mean, that's a cork. Is that one of your fish out?
Yeah, that's like one of the younger fish in our lake that stocked years ago. And they're slowly coming through now to sort of upper 20s to 30 pound now. Right. Lovely fish. It's not as old as it looks.
No, that's a clear water, doesn't it? Yeah. What's next on Jerry's agenda?
Oh, to just keep on, when the autumn's come in, it's my favourite time of the year. Yeah. I've been mucking around a lot on my own lake this year, like I said earlier, but I've got a few target waters now in mind, and now's the time to start really getting knuckled down and try and catch some.
Fantastic, mate. Well, I wish you all the best. I know you managed to get a few. You've certainly brought a few crackers into show, so I know you're good luck to you, mate. That's it for another week. A reminder, you can find all sorts of features and film from the show on our website. And please keep in touch with us via email and on Twitter. It's been great chatting to you, Jerry. As I said, thanks so much for coming in, mate.
It's been great. Pleasure.
Lovely. Next Friday, my guest will be sea angler and lure fanatic Henry Gilby. He's bound to keep us all entertained, I promise you that. Join us at the later time of 8 o'clock on Sky Sports 3. That's next week, 8 p.m, Sky Sports 3. And if you missed that or the repeats, don't forget the show's available on demand in the Sky Sports section of Catch Up, as well as loads of other little compilations. Have a superb week out there, whatever you're fishing for. Good luck and tight lines. Thanks, mate.
Nice one, Keith.
And good luck with your upcomings. I'll get some good fish to show us.
Keep you informed.
Thank you.
I look forward.
Enjoy Sky Sports Live. On all screens, on the go, and the best bits on demand.